Welcome to Lunch and Learn, and the beginning of an exciting new season of the West Michigan Symphony. This is really exciting. One of the things, my name is Scott Speck, by the way, I'm music director. One of the things that I love is to be able to present music that the audience may not have heard before that we think is so spectacularly good. It just needs to be played and needs to be heard here. And there's a lot of that this season. And a couple of the pieces on the program this week fall into the category of music that hasn't been played here before. But first, I want to introduce our special guest, a percussionist with the West Michigan Symphony. Please say hello to Joe LaPalomento.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
And I know that's why there's an extra big crowd here today, because you heard there was going to be percussion. And you thought, oh, maybe he'll bring some of his instruments and demonstrate.
Sure
and
did.
Sure enough. Yeah. So why don't we start with the you know, the obvious thing, which is this percussion setup. And I thought, you know, you can tell us, first off, about all of those mallets. Look at those two containers all full of different mallets.
Yeah.
Why is that necessary?
So I am playing timpani this week. So I've got my timpani mallets closer to you. Let me grab them so I can turn around and you can see them better.
Yeah.
So I've got quite a selection here of timpani mallets. So from the audience perspective, I'll be on the back right of the stage playing those big kettle drums. But these mallets are designed for hitting those instruments, all different hardnesses, so bigger, softer, fluffier sounds to quite hard. But this is like a wood, basically, hitting the drum with wood. So all different colors that I can get on timpani. I need all of these assortment of mallets. And then I also brought my general percussion bag, which is kind of my go-to mallets for any gigs that I do for percussion as well. Obviously, I'm in the percussion section, so I play with West Michigan Symphony percussion as well. And so I've got snare drum sticks and mallets for bells or xylophone or marimba.
Cymbals, right? Cymbal rolls?
Right, cymbal rolls, suspended cymbal rolls, vibraphone, all the different tools I need for my trade.
Yeah. This is something I find interesting, because it seems to me that for any other musician of the orchestra, at the most, they have to know how to play two different instruments, let's say, at the most. Usually it's one. And in your case, you have to learn how to play how many instruments, would you say?
Countless. I was just over at an old teacher's house, and he was bragging about he recently learned how to play saws bowed to pitches. So percussionists are asked to play all sorts of crazy things.
I mean, I would guess if there's something that the composer writes in the score that's not one of the traditional instruments, it would go to percussion, right?
Yeah, right. Typewriter, there's pieces where you have to play a typewriter.
Sure.
Yeah.
Very famous one,
yes,
by Leroy Anderson.
Certainly, yeah.
I saw there's this really amazing music. Maybe we'll do it someday. It's and I saw a performance of it that was recorded at Royal Albert Hall during the proms. This is, of course, I speak of the background music to Tom and Jerry, the cartoons.
Oh.
Have you seen this? Because there are notations in the score for things like plates being broken, you know, rocks being dropped, and even the sounds of barking dogs. And the sound of barking dogs, that would go to a percussionist, right?
Yeah, certainly. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Who else are you going to ask to do it, right?
Yeah, all sorts of screaming and hollering I've done. Percussion ensemble loves to do vocals, too. So I've done a fair amount of hooting and hollering.
Yeah. That's amazing. And there's quite a bit of hooting and hollering, well, not literally, in this program, because we have, if not the biggest, one of the biggest groups of musicians ever assembled on the stage here at the Frauenthal, because specifically of one piece on the program, which is the grand finale piece. And we'll get to it a little bit later, the Roman festivals of Respighi. But Respighi, as you know, the composer of Pines of Rome, Fountains of Rome, some great ancient airs and dances and many other pieces, he was trying in this piece to depict all kinds of sound effects and things going on out in the public square with people making lots of noise and all kinds of simultaneous celebrations going on. And that obviously calls for non-traditional instruments. But let's get to that a little bit later. I wonder if you could just give us a little demo of some of the toys that you brought
today.
Sure,
yes.
And that's a technical word, toys.
Toys, yeah. Well, to be fair, this one is a main food group, so we don't call it a toy, the snare drum. I'll play a little bit of that, and then I'll kind of give you a tour of the other things that I brought, which you will hear, not necessarily these particular versions, they're mine, but other percussionists will play versions of these instruments in the concert this week.
Anybody here want to try that? Joe, I wonder if you could just explain one thing, because the roll,
sure,
which is one of the hardest things to do, can you show how what the components are of a snare drum roll?
Certainly.
Yeah.
Can you guys hear me okay without bringing the microphone?
Yeah.
I could turn it this way. So with the roll, I remember when I was wanting to start percussion, I thought I had to play a roll just by moving my hands at warp speed. But actually, if you give the stick a little bit more of the responsibility in letting it bounce and make that buzz sound, you don't have to move your hand so fast. So I just spent a lot of time working on alternating my hands in buzzes so that they sound somewhat even, and then I just try to overlap those buzzes so that it sounds like a long tone, like ba. And that's many years in university to do that. Yeah,
I saw participated in a performance by the great percussionist Evelyn Glennie, who played the snare drum concerto by Askel Masson. You know that piece, I'm sure.
Yeah.
And the cadenza of the snare drum concerto, yes, there is a snare drum concerto, snare drum and orchestra. The cadenza was nothing more than a roll that was fortissimo, and after about 5 minutes, I realized she was making a diminuendo. And she was making a very, very gradual lessening of sound until it was down to pianissimo. And then she made another minute of crescendo before the climax. It was really quite incredible.
And an endurance piece, too.
Endurance?
Yeah, for sure.
What about Bolero?
Bolero, yeah. So a famous drum rhythm you might recognize. You have to play very soft at the beginning.
You have to play very soft at the beginning, but you have to play extremely loudly at the end.
Yeah.
And you're playing nonstop, right? For 15 minutes?
Yes. Yeah.
So Bolero is an incredible snare drum excerpt, because you have to be able to do this, and only this, I think. Only this
Until like the last two measures, yeah.
For 15 minutes, making a gradual crescendo from pianissimo to fortissimo. Can you show us what the fortissimo is like?
Sure. I won't be offended if anybody covers their ears. Yeah.
Maybe you could give us how about a crescendo from the pianissimo, maybe a roll, crescendo roll from
sure.
pianissimo to fortissimo.
Sure, yeah.
That's why we hired him, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Show us some more instruments.
Sure, yeah. So if you were wondering what I'm doing back here, I'm turning the snares off so that they don't sympathetically vibrate when I'm playing other instruments. Here's the snares on, as you were hearing a minute ago. Yeah. Okay. So let's just move in this direction, counterclockwise. I've got three different cymbal sizes here for whatever colors that I might be interested in. I'll play the smallest one first. So typically I would grab this pair if I needed some softer playing that I don't particularly think they're too useful, louder, but I'll start soft so you can hear what I like about them. They're pretty easy to play soft, as opposed to some of the other ones I'll show you. So those are 16-inch cymbals in diameter, and these are just 1 inch bigger, but they're quite a bit thicker. So these are kind of a little easier to play a lot of different dynamics and different articulations and things. So soft. you can get pretty loud with those. Yeah. And then finally, I have 1 inch bigger, 18-inch, and these are big honkers here.
Are the 18-inch ones the ones you would use for Wagner, for example, something like that?
Yes. And there are bigger. I just have not invested in the 20-inch, 22-inch variety that you'll find occasionally people will play. So it's a pretty big sound, yeah.
You can hear it's a thicker kind of sound, right? The first one kind of had almost a delicacy to it, not just in terms of the dynamic, but also we talk about the timbre, the sound quality that it's making, and it doesn't sound like a thick piece of metal. This one sounds like a thicker
piece. Yeah, it definitely is. And in terms of just cymbals, this particular style is quite thick. Yeah, there. Even at 18-inch, you can get some thinner ones that might sound a little bit closer to the first pair I played, but these are definitely, you know, the heavy artillery here.
And it's interesting that two of the three cymbals you have are Zildjian's. Those are Turkish brand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, cymbals did not regularly make it into the symphony orchestra until mid-19th century or so. And that's because there was, all throughout Europe, a fascination with what they called the Orient. And for them, anything east of Vienna was Oriental, right?
Mm-hmm.
Including Hungary. Hungarian music was absolutely...
Right.
So very much there was a fascination with Turkish music. And at that time, cymbals, which were Turkish, which originally are Turkish, found their way into the orchestra and never left. So
right.
Even that temporary fascination with, quote, Orientalism led to a permanent member of the symphony orchestra that everyone now regularly uses.
Thankfully,
yeah,
they do.
Thankfully, yeah. It's my favorite instrument, actually.
Oh.
It's my favorite percussion, instrument. Let me qualify that, too,
yeah. Yeah.
All right. Yours, too?
Yeah, I love cymbals. Since high school, I love playing cymbals. There's just a lot of colors that you get to choose from that aren't written on the page. You get a lot of artistic liberty in making choices about which pair you want and then how you want to play them with a different articulation, real sharp crashes or washy, kind of like a wave crashing against rocks, that sort of sound.
If I held one up, could you do a roll on it?
Yeah.
Let's try that. That's my favorite.
Yeah.
So, just amazing. Okay, let's move on.
Sure. So then I've got some triangles, two pretty different triangles here. I'll play the more standard one first. So I was just doing a little choking with my left hand that I'm holding and playing for those dead strokes and then not touching the triangle to let it ring that standard triangle sound and the famous triangle roll. Yeah.
Cool. You said you have another one?
Yeah.
Let's hear the difference.
So this one's kind of more like a grandfather clock or something. So you kind of need a special moment to have this color. Just made of a different metal and the way it's shaped, it gets a different color.
It's lower, but you still can make it sound delicate
the way
you play it.
Yeah. Depending on where you play it on the triangle, like if I play pretty close to the little vertex here, I'll get a lot of the highs that the triangle can make, and if I move away, I'll get a lot of the lows that the triangle is capable of making.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I recently, about a year ago, conducted a premiere of a piece by Augusta Reed Thomas, wonderful composer, that she wrote for 300 bells and orchestra, and that included triangles. So there were lots of triangles, and I remember hearing a lot of that sound.
Yeah.
All right, what do we got next?
So this is called a ratchet. So it does sound like the ratchet in your toolbox, but just like amplified to be a musical instrument now. And you will hear that this week. Yeah. Yeah.
That's in the Respighi for sure. Right?
Yes, it is.
Anything else? Is it in the Strauss? I can't remember.
I think so, yeah.
In the waltz at one point, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, interesting.
Yeah.
All right. What else?
tambourines, two different tambourines. They're both the same size, but the jingles are made of different materials, so they have a different color again, like the triangles. So this is my more typical sounding tambourine. And I just did a finger roll, which when I play for middle schoolers, that usually makes their jaws drop.
Did you put something on there to make it more friction?
It's a little bit unusual, yeah. But it's a fine-grained sandpaper I put on the head so that it's easier to get that grip for those finger rolls.
So by the end of the respeaky, you're bleeding, actually.
Right. Yeah, right. Yeah, and then, of course, you can have the shake roll. Yeah.
And I find it interesting that a lot of times when we see something written by a composer and we think it's actually someone shaking the tambourine or something more loose, that actually the percussionist is doing a very controlled motion to get that.
Right, yeah.
Here's an interesting thing for the cymbal crashes.
Mm-hmm.
Someone once gave me the trick that if they can't get the cymbal to crash quietly enough, they take one cymbal and use a quarter, edge of a quarter on it, and go, and it sounds.
Oh, okay.
I just thought I'd give you that.
Thank you. Thank you for the tip. Yeah. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, so I have two tambourines, as I said. This one is a mix of chromium 25 and German silver. The other one is German silver, but it was treated in a funny way, so it just has a different color. Not crazy different. It's still a tambourine, but it's a little different color, right?
Definitely lower, yeah.
So this one, it's a little crunchier to my ear. So if I want something a little bit more articulate or heavy sounding, I might go to this one.
So a lot of times in rehearsals, obviously conductors are generally not experts in percussion or in any particular instrument or most of the instruments that they're working with. And so it depends on the player to come up with the best instrument to use for any given passage, right? And I might, as a musician, I might ask for a certain type of sound, like could it be richer or could it be brittler or something like that, but then it would be up to Joe to figure out what instrument to choose, right, to make that
and
happen.
When I was a young percussionist, like in college, we used to hate when conductors would say that because we had no idea what to do. But as a professional and you start to develop a range of sounds that you're familiar with, it's kind of nice when a conductor gives you something vague so that you can make the decision rather than them telling you, get those sticks out, and you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's one thing I've learned as a conductor is the better the orchestra is, the more general you want to make your directions or requests, because they're artists and they can figure out how to translate a sound into an instrument. Whereas you wouldn't want to spoon feed them. It would be just the same as if you told someone to write something using a different pen or something like that. Let them figure that out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What else?
I brought various bass drum beaters. So you will actually see a pair very similar to this in the concert. They're a matching pair, so if you have to do rolls on the bass drum, so that's that big bass drum, the big drum that's like this big, that is usually, the head is kind of vertical. If you need to do rolls, you can use a pair of mallets. And like I was doing on the snare drum, sort of, you can use these mallets. But also, you can flip around. This blue side is a little harder. So if you need to do really articulate, fast rhythms, you can do with these same mallets, a quick switch. And then this guy here is just only one hardness, but it's a fairly articulate mallet. And then I've got this kind of nerdy bass drum muffling glove that my wife sewed for me. So it's just some fabric, fuzzy fabric I found at like a Michaels or something. And then I put it on my left hand, so if I want to be really nerdy and careful with the bass drum muting, so when I want the drum to be quiet, not ring anymore, I can dampen it with this glove hand. If I use my fleshy hand, sometimes you'll get a little buzzy sound, because the bass drum head is quite a bit more loose than this snare drum head, and it actually moves a fair amount when you hit it. So when you try to dampen it with your hand, sometimes you get a little zzz, you know, and if I want to be really careful, you might see me using this. But That's being
That's great.
Extra careful.
Is that all the toys you brought? Is that everything?
I think so, yes. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's great. Thank you for the demonstration. Great. I learned a lot. And now I want to get Joe's input on some of the music that we're playing. Gabe Slimko up there. Actually, Gabe is so multi-talented. One of the things Gabe can tell us is, how many percussionists did we hire for this concert?
Seven.
Woo! Seven percussionists. Seven. So it's going to be loud at those climaxes, because several of the instruments that Joe just played for you are going to be played simultaneously at the end. Can we start at the beginning of the Bernstein? Our concert opens with our tribute to Leonard Bernstein, you know, for his 100th birthday, which would have been this year. In fact, his birthday was just, I think, last month. And so it's getting toward the end of his worldwide birthday celebration. Orchestras all over the world are playing his music for that reason, but also because it's great. And Candide Overture is one of those pieces, even though it's written obviously in a throwback style, trying to write it sort of in operetta form, which would not have been the way people would have thought to normally write music in the 1950s. But it's proven to be extraordinarily resilient piece and probably his most played piece by orchestras. Let's just play the beginning of Candide, because it's raucous and it has quite a bit of percussion. Okay, so let's stop there. So, I'm just curious, from you guys, what percussion instruments did you hear being performed?
All of them.
All of them. For example? Bass drum, yes. What else? Lots of timpani, and by the way, that's going to be Joe in this concert.
Yeah.
Xylophone, is that what I heard? What else? Yes. Lots of it. What else?
Mm-hmm.
Cymbal, crash cymbals. Anything else, Joe, that we forgot?
We said snare drum, I think.
Snare drum.
Yeah. I think that might have been it. Mm. Yeah. But quite a lot of people busy in that beginning. Yeah.
So it's interesting, isn't it, to listen from the point of view of having just learned about percussion, and now what percussion do we hear in this? The overture has two main themes, really, the one that you heard at the beginning, and then a slower, more lyrical one, or I should say quieter, more lyrical one, originally played by violas, and then the whole orchestra takes it over, and it becomes the climax of the piece when it comes back. It's a very simple structure. It's kind of actually almost like a sonata form type of thing, or sonatina form, and it's easy to comprehend. It doesn't need a whole lot of explanation, which is great. Second on the program is a piece by Richard Strauss, who is also a throwback composer. In other words, he lived until 1949, but until the end of his life, he wrote like someone in the late 19th century. And thank goodness for that, because it's some of the most glorious music ever written. The four last songs, for example, are among the most beautiful pieces ever, and certainly, I would say, the best thing ever written for soprano solo and orchestra. And the Rosenkavalier, though, which was written several years earlier, I think in 1910, Rosenkavalier was a throwback opera in that he had just written two really bombastic, extraordinarily dissonant operas, Salome, which caused a sensation and scandal, and Electra. Both of these are unbelievably loud and very much in-your-face type of music.
Great percussion, though.
Great percussion.
Yeah.
I'm not saying there's anything wrong with them. They're fantastic. But then he was given a libretto, by Hugo von Hofmannsthal, who had done the librettos for Salome and Electra as well, I believe. And this was a very much sort of almost a Marriage of Figaro type of story, kind of, you know, mistaken identity. There's actually, believe it or not, in this opera, a mezzo-soprano, so it's a woman, plays a guy who dresses up as a woman. So, yeah, there's a scene where a girl's playing a boy playing a girl, and it's hilarious. Anyway, it was such a throwback, and it was so easy for Strauss to imagine a story like this having been composed by someone like Mozart, who, by the way, was his hero, that he said the music just flowed like butter mixed with oil. And it was just so easy for him to write. And it is one of the most beloved operas of all time. Maybe we'll play the very beginning if we have that. I don't know if there's too much interesting percussion at the beginning.
More at the end.
But let's listen to the beginning just so you get an idea of this late Romantic style. Gabe, could... All right. I want to talk about something near the beginning. Keep it going. This is actually supposed to depict, with the curtain down at the beginning of the opera, lovemaking between the main character, the Marcheline, and her lover, Octavian. And so this all happens with the curtain down, so it's very discreet, but just listen for a second. Thank you. And that is, for those in the know, the most obscene thing ever written for symphony orchestra. this is a piece where we would really spend a lot more time talking about it at Lunch and Learn if I had a horn player or a trumpet player right next to me, because it's such a brass-heavy piece, and the brass gets to play not only wonderful fanfares, but also incredible moments of intimate beauty. In fact, that's one of the things I think most characterizes regards Strauss, that he's able to... project these musical high points, huge body of sound, filling the hall, coming from the stage. But at the same time, he's able somehow, with his orchestration and with his, you know, especially really masterful use of harmony, to create the most intimate sounds you could imagine from coming from an orchestra. And I've always felt that way about Richard Strauss, almost everything that he writes, and some of the other Germans, Mahler, and actually he was an Austrian, wasn't he? But Germanic, Reger is another one who could do it. There's something about the way these very late Romantics approached harmony that was allowed them to express in music certain sentiments and certain very specific feelings that no one else has been able to do. And Richard Strauss used to brag about that, by the way. When he wrote Don Juan, he said, if the audience cannot hear that Don Juan's second lover is a redhead, then I have failed. So he failed, but he'd really tried. Anyway, so the Rosenkavalier suite is basically greatest hits from the opera. The opera is 3-something hours long, and the suite is about 20, 25 minutes long. And it includes some absolutely ravishing waltzes, because, you know, it's sort of a Viennese type of story, and you just hear some of the most beautiful waltzes that could have been written by Johann Strauss, no relation, but very much sort of adopted by Richard Strauss in his style. Is there anything else about Rosenkavalier you want to say?
You can hear a very common bell excerpt when there's like a carnival scene, there's like an organ grinder sound coming from the orchestra in another waltz. But that bell part that you'll hear Matt play Matt Beck, our principal percussionist. He's doing a great job. But that's a famous bell part that you have to learn in college.
A little insider information. Matt Beck, our principal percussionist, in his audition, actually made me cry playing the bells. That's how he won the job, in a good way.
Wow. In a good way. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Next, we have, and this is to begin the second half of the concert, Berlioz Overture to the Roman Carnival. It's supposed to depict Mardi Gras. That's it. So plain and simple, it's Mardi Gras. Let's listen to just the very beginning, and I mean really the very beginning, first 10 seconds. It. Then it gets quiet for a long time, beautiful slow melody, and then the fast carnival begins in earnest. Is there any percussion at all there?
Mm-mm.
There wasn't, was there?
No.
Nothing, no percussion. But it comes at the end, lots of tambourine especially.
Yes,
absolutely. As we're dancing along.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to say about that piece?
It's a lot of fun to play on timpani as well. I mean, we're just making a lot of noise and it's a blast, yeah.
I will say that the orchestra is quite familiar with the Roman Carnival and is quite familiar with Candide from having played them in many other settings. Most of our musicians also play other places. But many of them have never played the Rosenkavalier before, and many of them have never played Roman festivals before. Those who have been around here for a while might remember that we did play it some 12 years ago or something like that here at the West Michigan Symphony, but the orchestra has grown and changed and evolved, and so we have a lot of people now who have not played it. Roman festivals, like all of the Respighi Rome tone poems, consists of four movements, each of which is a completely different scene, and in this case, it's a different festival taking place within Rome. The very beginning, we hear a really kind of harrowing scene. It takes place in ancient Rome in the Colosseum, where a Christian and a lion are facing off. And you can tell that it's a Christian because he's represented by a Gregorian chant that you hear played in the orchestra. And the lion is played by mostly trombones and trumpets. Pass on having us play that now because it's kind of a long excerpt, but I want you to be aware when you listen to it with the whole orchestra that this is a very graphic depiction of what happens when those two face off, and you might want to cover the ears of your kids at the climax because it's really, really graphic, and you can guess who wins in this confrontation. The second scene is, if you can imagine, pilgrims slowly trudging and marching toward, they don't quite know what. They're making a pilgrimage. And it sounds, again, sort of like Gregorian chants going on. So again, you're hearing a very religious procession. And then, as they go up the hill, and they reach sort of the summit of the hill, there is a moment where they suddenly see what they've been looking for. And at that moment, we hear the pealing of all the bells at once in Rome. It's like as if all the cathedrals are ringing their bells at the same time. It's a moment of religious ecstasy. It calls for some very difficult cross rhythms. There are times when, for example, the cellos and basses and low brass are going bum, 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 bum. And everyone else is playing those same notes, but just out of phase by a 16th note. So it's da, 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 da. You know what? You see what I'm doing? Da, 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 but and much faster. Does that pose extra difficulties for the percussion?
Certainly. It's hard to, we were just working on that section last night. But it's hard to find the voices that you play with because there's so much happening and people are playing halfway in between where you're playing. So you just kind of grasp on those bassoons next to me and I play with them. But yeah, mine isn't as tough as some of those voices there, halfway in between. I play on a lot of downbeats, thankfully.
That's good. Yeah. So that's the second of the four scenes. The third scene is called L'Ottobrata, which you being Italian probably know what that means.
It's like an Oktoberfest.
Oktoberfest, right?
Yeah.
So it's festive, but it's not really raucous, at least in this depiction of it.
Yeah. I was reading about it. It's like he's thinking of a festival in Piazza Navona in Rome, and like there's a bunch of percussion, like jingle bells, like there's just people marching the streets with percussion instruments and street musicians and, you know, fun bell parts and things like that.
And then suddenly it gets very, very quiet, and there's a melody played by a mandolin, of all things. We have mandolins and ratchets and organ in this concert. And the moment where the mandolin plays, to me, is my favorite moment of this. It's actually the quietest. It's the most intimate. And it's suddenly as if everything has focused down to a very, very small canvas, and we are all concentrating on this one player and really trying to support the music coming from the quiet mandolin. And that is, maybe it's the late evening or something in the festival, where suddenly things have quieted down, and all you have are the stars outside, and we're just enjoying the after effects of the wine and so on. It's a really comfortable feeling. And then the fourth scene is called Epiphany, La Befana, and it's a festival that is really taking place on some square where, as in the music of Stravinsky, like Petrushka, or in Charles Ives's piece, Central Park in the Dark, you're hearing five or six different things going on simultaneously in different rhythms. And it's a complete cacophony. Let's play the beginning of the last movement of Roman festivals. Okay, let's talk. So that's only the first minute, yeah? I got to tell you, the West Michigan Symphony, to be able to pull off the Candide Overture and Rosenkavalier and the Berlioz and all of this in one concert really speaks to what a wonderful orchestra we have here in this community. To be able to play all that on the small amount of rehearsals we have, thank you. But it's true. Let's speak a little bit to the percussion that we just heard.
Sure. I think like the percussion and timpani are kind of outlining a lot of the activity that other instruments are presenting in these like overlapping activity that's happening in the orchestra. So we've got like I mentioned before, those blue and white mallets. Eric will be playing cymbals and bass drum at the same time for a part of that. And there's tambourine and triangle and cymbals, and I'll be playing timpani. You know,
keep in mind, for someone to be playing cymbals and bass drum at the same time, when we have seven other percussionists, really means there's a lot of percussion
there
in, right?
There is a lot.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. The way he attaches this, he attaches one of the cymbals to the bass drum, and then he'll hold the other cymbal with his left hand. Then he's got a bass drum beater in his right hand, so he's got to coordinate that. It's not super easy. Yeah.
Wow. I think now is a really good time for us to see if there's any questions from our audience.